So, before configuration management, right, let's say you have a very simple architecture where you have one management node which you would be using to SSH into your server, which would be somewhere around in the web, right? And you SSH into it, and you do some stuff like configuring, let's say, Nginx, deploy that database, migrating some database, inserting some new configurations, stuff like that, right? So the problem comes when you have a whole lot of devs in your team. Let's say you are a team of 10 people and some guy does some configuration, but he hasn't documented it, right? But we should be following that practice, but most people don't follow it. I mean, that should be the ideal case, but it doesn't happen, right? So you actually don't know what happened in your server, right? For a particular state to be attained, right? So this results in flaky servers, so as to say, right? So how does Ansible help in solving this problem, right? So this talk would not be a comparison of different tools like Chef, Puppet, and Ansible, because that is something very subjective and would be best solved by discussing with the internal team, right? Every tool solves its own problem, and I personally think it's more of a, like, you should be knowing all the tools which help you solve a particular problem, right? So I just started with Ansible because I was familiar with Python previously, so that's the story behind it, right? And so it follows the push approach. By push, we mean that, like, let's say you have a management node and you have a node which is being managed by a controlling node. So what you do is you push configurations to it, right? You like SSH into it and you give some configuration to it which is being run inside that, right? This is dissimilar to other configuration tools like Puppet, which follow a pull in a pull mechanism. Like, let's say you have three servers and behind that you have an agent which tries to, let's say, pull configurations from your inventory, right? Which would be holding all your configuration. So your node would be actively pulling the configurations out of your node, which is actually hosting the configuration. So this is one difference which I would say. And as I said, right, it is agentless. You don't require anything to be installed other than SSH and Python on the node which you are trying to configure, right? One more thing which I really think would be something very, it doesn't come on the way of you to configure your server, right? You don't have to learn a lot of DSL, unlike other configuration management tools. You just have to, it's like formatted in easy YAML configuration files. So we will see later on how a YAML looks like. And it runs tasks in a sequential manner. So let's say you have a series of tasks which are needed to be run on your server. So it runs them in a sequential manner. This is, again, dissimilar to the way in which Puppet deals with running your tasks. So, as I said, right, when I mentioned flaky servers, before working on your server, you would be provisioning something, right? Like, let's say you wanted a set tool of internal tools to be provisioned inside your server. Let's say you wanted a particular version of MySQL, you wanted your particular Vim config inside your server to work before it. So again, stressing on the point, it helps you create servers where you actually know what the state of the server is, right? So that's where immutable infrastructure comes in. So this has been popularized from some time back, maybe 2011 or 12. So the idea behind it is, let's say your web server, right? You deployed it using a configuration management tool. So what this helps in doing is, let's say your web server goes down immediately. Now you have a page duty on you, and then you don't know what to do, right? So what this helps in doing is, it will help you immediately replicate your server which went down, right? Imagine the downtime which you would be having when you are manually SSHing into your server and doing all that stuff, right? Again, one more thing is which I would want to stress on it, it's like idempotency, right? So what this means is, let's say I have a task which I run on my server, right? Now I'm creating a user called bankpipers. Now let's say I run the Ansible task once to create that user. I don't want it to be created again, right? That would be a waste of time, as well as my time, right? So what this does, like what Ansible makes sure is on its side is that like each module, like the creation of the user should be done only once so that you don't waste your time on that. So this would this would be a very rough architecture of that simple example which I went through previous. So it just requires at minimum two basic configuration files. One would be the host inventory and the other would be the YAML config which you would be specifying the tasks in. So the host inventory would just hold the IP ad- like the IP address of the server and a whole lot of things. So this would be a simple example of how inventory file looks like. So by default it's placed in this path. So this would be a simple config file. So you can see is what you can see is it like stores a list of web servers or hosts which you would be managing through Ansible. So in this case, test droplets would be a group name inside which you would be having hosts. This would be another group. So similarly, you can have a lot of groups inside this host. And you are specifying some variables which are which would be usually Ansible underscore host. This would be the the IP address of the server which you are handling. So as I said, the default path would be XC Ansible hosts, which would be created on your node, which would be managing the servers. You can also you also have the option of like specifying the path of the inventory file. And as I said, like test droplets would be the group name and the Ubuntu 14.04 would be the host name inside that group. So hosts can coexist in different group names per se. Let's say you have a server which also is the DB server but also is a web server, right? So it makes sense to club them together. And furthermore, like you can also have some configuration variables inside the place where you have your root folder, inventory folder. Now the power of Ansible, there's something called as ad hoc commands in Ansible in which you would be, the general syntax would look like something like this, right? Now, before this I would like to say like there are various ways of installing Ansible on your controlling node. Like this would be specific to the node, like the operating system of your node, right? For Mac per se, I just did a pip install Ansible which would be putting my the latest version of Ansible inside my Mac. So the general syntax would look something like this, right? So Ansible followed by the host group which you saw the test droplets, this would come inside here. In Ansible terminology, it would be also known as patterns, right? Like let's say you have example 0 dot host 0.example.com. So you see a common pattern, right? Let's say you have servers named host 0, host 1, host 2. So there would be a common pattern, right? You can also do a star inside your inventory file, a star.example.com, which would automatically consider all the host names named star, like in a regex pattern, right? Like, so let's see a very simple example of how. So I already have a
font size can increase.
Sorry. Is it visible?
No.
One more.
Sorry?
One more.
Yeah. So I already have a DigitalOcean droplet running with the IP 139.59.76.99. As I said, Ansible uses SSH to connect to your server. So I already have my public key placed inside that server. So when I try to SSH inside it, it would not give me an error. So let's see whether everything works fine or not. So what I'm doing with the minus L flag is I'm limiting inside the group name and I'm limiting only to the host name called Ubuntu. So I'm specifying the minus u flag stands for the username which I want to log in inside my server using Ansible, so that would be root. The minus m flag again specifies the module which I want to use, which would be ping. So we will see later on, like, Ansible has a whole bunch of modules which we can use to run on our servers. So this is returning something as simple as saying that the ping was successful. I was successfully able to connect with my server, host named Ubu. Now this so you can do a whole lot of things with this minus m module. Let's say you wanted to see what the free memory inside the server is, right? So the error which showed right now was because I used the shell module, I need to pass additional parameters inside it. So I'm doing that by passing the minus a flag.
Free minus m.
So as you can see, the free memory right now for that particular droplet inside DigitalOcean would be somewhere around 500 MBs, right? You can do all kinds of stuff like manipulating particular config lines with, there are modules for doing that too, right? You can copy files from your source, like say controlling node to your destination node, and all kinds of modules, which you would be seeing in a while. Now the real power of Ansible comes from the pattern called Ansible playbook. So what you can do is, instead of doing ad hoc commands, right, one-off commands which you would be specifying on the terminal, let's say you just wanted to turn up. So ad hoc commands should be more specifically targeted to tasks which you wanted to do just once, right? Let's say you have a whole bunch of servers inside your inventory file. You just specified 10 bunch of servers inside some group name, right? You wanted to turn them off before going off to sleep, right? You just ran an Ansible ad hoc command and that's it, right? But for larger commands, let's say you wanted to put up a load balancer in front of 6 Nginx servers, you won't be writing ad hoc commands for that, right? So that's where Ansible playbooks come around. So it's just a series of commands in YAML config configuration. So this would be a very simple Ansible playbook, which would be the task of which would be to do installing Nginx inside my droplet or remote server or whatever cloud provider you have been using. And I'm just modifying the file which actually serves the default Nginx page, right? So let's run through it once. So the YAML configuration says that it starts with 3 lines you have. So that's just a terminology, right? That's just how you start writing YAML files. And the slash which you see on the second line is basically specifying lists, right? So each YAML file starts with a list. And the first list element inside that YAML file would be hosts. So this would just be a key value pair or a dictionary. So people who are like familiar with Python would can correlate to this as specifying dictionary values, right? Key value pairs. So hosts, the key would be the list would be hosts and then Nginx, and then you are specifying. So hosts would be specifying the specific group of hosts or servers which I want to work with using this Ansible playbook, and Nginx would be the name. Now remote user would be something which I am logging in inside the server. Vars would be something which I'm about to pass to my playbook. So this uses Jinja2 templating engine. So someone who has used Jinja2 while using like playing around with Django or Flask would feel right at home, right? And the thing which actually runs, right, which is of actual importance, is this part, right? So you have the list element tasks which would be having a dictionary specifying the tasks which need to be run in a sequential order. So the first thing which you can see is the name of the task itself. So this is mandatory; you cannot skip it, right? So what, as the name suggests, it would be installing Ansible. So this would be this argument inside that dictionary, the app module specifically, would be used for specifying what module I'm using for doing this particular task, right? And so I'm using the app module, I'm passing in the package name, which I'm specifying as Nginx, and I want it to be installed, right? And I want it to be installed. Going again back to the point where I said tasks should be idempotent. So when I run this again, if Ansible is already installed Nginx in that particular system, this would just be skipped. It is just checking the state, whether it is installed or not, right? And I'm also updating the cache, but that doesn't actually affect that much. So what am I doing next? So this would be another task named Nginx remove default index.html. And inside that, I'm using the module called file. So I'm just removing the default starter page, which just shows you welcome to Nginx, similar to what Apache does. And I'm replacing it on the next task with a file of my own, which is on my controlling node, right? So I'm copying that file and then passing it to I'm copying it to the same destination from where I removed my default Nginx startup landing page. And what I'm doing here is I'm creating an event handler. Let's say when you are changing some configurations in your web server, right? You want it to be restarted for the effects to take change. Like, this is a very simple example, but for other tasks which you would be doing later on, you would obviously need to restart your server, right? So I'm creating an event where I would be using the keyword, the keyword called notify. So this would create an event which executes a task at the bottom of the playbook. So this is the part where I'm handling this event, right? And it's just a normal string, right? As you can see, you have the same syntax as the task which you did earlier. So here I'm restarting Nginx. So there's another module called service, which would actually restart. So this is very human readable, as you all can see, right? Anybody can understand, even your operations guy or someone who has just started using Ansible can understand this statement. What does it do? I mean, it just takes a service called Nginx and then restarts it, right? As simple as that. So the thing to note is, important thing to note here is that this gets executed only at the last of the playbook. So let's see if we can have this running. So I'm creating a new droplet for that Nginx container. I will only be creating a $5 instance because I am broke. So I'm just trying to copy this IP address inside my inventory file, right, so that I can manage it. So till the server gets provisioned, let's put it into my inventory file. Important thing to note here is that I'm not able to ping on my remote server. The reason being, Python was not installed in that remote server, right? And I don't know why Ubuntu 16.4 on DigitalOcean doesn't come with Python installed by default, right? So I need to do that first. Just like Ansible is a command, there's also one more command called Ansible playbook. And the next argument which I'm giving is the playbook which I want to run. The next argument which you are seeing here is the user which I want to log into. And these are all some basic information which Ansible is spitting out to you. You can make it verbose by passing another flag called minus V, and then keep on going to three levels maybe, minus VVV, which would also give you some JSON formatted facts, right? Facts would be nothing but information which I'm gathering from the remote server. Let's say how much RAM it is having, how much swap space it is having, how many cores it is having, which would be actually useful when you are trying to build, deploy something which is using multiple cores. And you can actually, inside your playbook, based on these facts, skip some tasks or use those variables inside it. So as you can see, the first thing which Ansible does is like try to ping it, the server, it returns an OK, and then the first task is run, right? As I said, it's running sequentially. So the first task is done, so it's showing a change status. It's showing a change status, so Nginx is installed. The next, and as the other tasks are executed, you are seeing the other things, right? So let's see if our server got actually provisioned or not. So there you go, this is the default page this is the default Nginx page which I just modified. I think the font size is too big, but I'm not a front-end developer, so please don't mind. Now, as I said, right, there's something called as idempotency, right? So if I have run some particular tasks, or to be precisely put, if my server is on a particular state, right? Let's see if something changes again, if I run it again. So as you can see, as Nginx was already installed, it didn't do anything. Now, since most shell, I should put it this way, since most shell commands change something in your server, most of the time it's not going to be idempotent. So as evidently you have seen, it's actually changing the configuration file. So that part is something which you have to take care of, right? Ansible is not going to do that for you, right?
So basically, I think you're copying the file again. That's the reason it is the change.
Yeah. Right? So I can put, one way to make it idempotent is I can, before this task of copying, I can check whether. Exactly. So this would be one of the very, like a hack, I would say, it would be more like a hack to check whether the particular configuration file exists or not, right? I can do a regex check whether a particular line inside that file is existing or not. And based on that, I can again create a handler. Or conditional, right? But I think I'm going out of scope for this playbook. So this is just the playbook which you just saw. Now the thing to note is you can have multiple playbooks. So what you just saw on the top, this, right? This whole thing is a play. This whole thing is a play, right? and you can have multiple plays inside your Ansible playbook to be like, let's say you wanted some configuration files to be put before your DB was set up, right? Like, let's say populating things inside it maybe, and then maybe you get the gist, right? Like there would be some logical tasks which need to be done before a particular task is done. So you can organize it this way, right? And one more thing to note is like you can always put like, let's say you have two hosts name which need to be like executed the same playbook role, right? You can do that by putting a colon in, like, and separate them with a colon, which I didn't see in my slide, I guess. Right? And there are two ways of specifying items inside your module, like passing arguments to it. As I said, each module takes a key pair value, right? Key value pair, right? So if you see it inside, as you have seen inside the Sublime Text thingy, like, it gets out of the screen sometimes. So just to increase readability, what you can do is the same thing looks like this. Make sense? Any questions still now? So this is, but let's say you have, as you saw just a basic example of how a play looks like, you would be guessing how would a playbook look like. I mean, it would be a mess, right? If you had a whole bunch of tasks to be executed for, I mean, obviously nobody would be doing like very basic stuff like me, right? For the deploying the servers, it would be a whole bunch of complex tasks, right? So how do you make it more modular? Because the whole thing of like using a tool like this would be to make your lives easier, not worse, right? So how do you solve this? Like, how do you properly organize? 5 minutes. So the problem is solved by Ansible roles. So it would be, I'm skipping this. So how would a role look like? I mean, let's say you have, so a role would be nothing but a modular, division of tasks which you need to do. Let's say you just wanted to install Nginx, you wanted to install this, you wanted to install that. So, and more common stuff, like more things inside that, right? So you would be, so this is the general architecture, like layout of how the files should look like. And you are including each role inside your, so there would be a file called play.yml here, or site.yml as the documentation suggests you to name your parent playbook. So what inside that you would be having something like this, right? The usual things, and inside this, instead of tasks, you are specifying roles which you need to include, right? The bunch of playbooks which you saw, which I have modularized and kept inside particular folders. As common, you can have Nginx, you can have other things, right? And you are just including them using this simple notation, right? And these are just some things which are inside that layout. Like you are seeing a bunch of file, like things, right, inside this layout. There's files, there's templates, there's tasks. So these all mean something particular to Ansible of how it works with your role. So let's say you wanted to put out a dependency, right, in your role. Like, let's say you have a dependency of common to be executed before another role called DB, right? So you would put it inside this. There would be a file called main.yml inside this, and you would be just putting your dependency that common should be executed before this DB role. Default would be one place where I am putting my variables which would be used inside this particular, let's say, role. Handlers would be something which you just saw, that notify Nginx restart thingy. You would be putting this right here. Tasks would be, again, as the logical explanation of the name says, you would be putting what are the tasks which need to be executed. Templates would be the Jinja 2 templates which you would be. So I didn't show you the Jinja 2 template for the Nginx role, I guess. So this is what I was actually passing it around. So as you can see, this comes right around how you like replace a variable in Jinja 2. So I am passing a variable called welcome to April meetup inside this Jinja 2 templating, and it is getting replaced there. So as I said, right, things, a file called main.yml, you can name it anything, but Ansible prefers it as main.yml because it gets automatically included. Otherwise, you have to specifically place a directive called include, followed by a colon, and then the absolute relative path of where your file is, which you need to include. I would like to end this by showing something which I created for like bootstrapping my cloud VMs before I get to work on it. Like as I said, right, you would be having, what you say, is it visible? Is this part visible? No. Is this visible? At the back is it visible? Yeah. So as I said, right, like let's say this is a very dumb example of how I wanted to bootstrap my DigitalOcean server, right? Let's say I created a droplet. Now there are a whole bunch of things which I need to do inside that. Like let's say create swap memory, push my vim RC inside it, update some bare minimal packages inside it. Like let's say I wanted git, I wanted desktop inside it, and stuff like that, right? Just common stuff. So as you can see, you have on the top layer the parent role directory, which should be having the roles, right? So you can see the basic server hardening part where I'm actually installing a basic firewall, UFW, specifying the ports which need to be allowed. And you have seen the creating a new user. So I wanted a new non-root user inside my server, which I can SSH into without specifying the password. And install some minimal packages and stuff like that, right? Makes sense? Any questions till now? So how does the root play.yml look like, right? So this is the file which stitches all the roles together, right? I'm specifying the host name on which it needs to be run, the roles. So as I said, right, there are multiple ways in which Ansible takes on configuration. As I said, this would be a key inside, this would be a list element, and this would be dictionaries, a list of dictionaries to be precisely put. So if this is a list of dictionaries, this would be a dictionary, right? So not specifying it, on the previous playbooks, I was not specifying this curly braces. So this would be another way of specifying, a list of dictionaries, right? So do we have time for this?
No. You can finish this.
Should I run?
No, you can.
Yeah. So I would like to end with a quote from the Ansible docs, which I would like to repeat again. If Ansible modules are the tools in your workshop, playbooks are your instruction manuals, and your inventory of hosts are your raw material. With that, I would like to...
You can execute your playbook.
Oh, sure. So I think that. So I have already created a remote droplet called Ubuntu BLR. So I have already installed Python. So that was just for the brevity of the conversation, that Python just needs to be installed in the remote server, right? So as I said, you can increase the verbosity of the playbook task. So as you can see, Ansible is putting a whole bunch of things which you want to see if you're debugging something. Let's say a task is failing, right? Somewhere around this. A task is failing. What do you do? Like, how do you even debug it? I mean, so you can actually have a look at the JSON output which Ansible is putting out when he's executing your tasks. So at moment it's trying to update my apt-get, which I should have excluded by using something called as stacks. So let's say you have something which is unnecessary, right? Let's say like updating my apt-get right now. Before that I have even run an apt-get using an ad hoc command. So there's something called as stacks in Ansible, using which you can let's say run only a specific part of your playbook or exclude a specific part of your playbook. I didn't show it because this was just meant to be, I didn't show a whole lot of things just because this was an introduction, but I would love to like share some of the things which I have learned on my task of like rabbit hole down Ansible. So the thing is, the story of how I actually even got started with Ansible, right? So there's this college project which I'm doing, which involves OpenCV, right? And who has installed OpenCV here? Can we have a quick show of that? So you might be knowing it would be a real pain, right, to install all that stuff. At one point, you would obviously be forgetting what task you, what command you ran, right? And it makes no sense to run it again and again if some make compilation error happens, right? So I just thought there would be a better way to do this. I'm definitely not typing it again and again. And Ansible just solved the problem for me. So I have a Git repo which actually helps you install OpenCV version 3.0 on your, let's say, virtual environment. So Ansible is cool on the fact that he can also do tasks on your local environment. Like you can actually put your VirtualBox, run it and then point your Ansible SSH connection to that and install it. So quickly coming back to whatever Ansible did right here. So it ran without any errors, right? I mean, oh my god, right? So no errors, right? No errors. So let's see what is there inside my... So TaskDeck would be the name of the user which I have created, and it has like some bare minimum things. It has my Vim config, it has desktop, and like the usual stuff, creating a swap memory, a basic firewall setup. You can do all kinds of stuff inside it, but as this gets the stuff done for my role. So you get the gist, right? I mean, so with that, I would like point to some references, which would be nothing but the docs. So Ansible has some really good docs, so if you wanted to get started with Ansible on your developer workflow, Ansible would be a really good tool according to me. I mean, it got the stuff done for me. I mean, so I'm not even right out of college, and I can make sense of this, right? You get the sense, right? So with that, I'm if there are any questions, I would be happy to take.
I mean, I know there are a couple of servers you are setting up, SSH is easy, you want to do this.
Yeah, yeah.
If you are dynamically building a lot of things, how do you set up the SSH itself?
Yeah, so there's, coming back to his question is I'm specifying host IPs on my, inventory file manually, right? How would I get a, let's say I have a whole lot of servers which I'm creating on the go. How would I provision them? So there's this thing called dynamic inventories inside Ansible. So with that, what you can do is there are some configurations which need to be done beforehand. So what it does is this module would get it would get the IPs associated with your cloud provider account and do all the stuff which you get need to be done. So that would be something which gets that sort, dynamic inventories. Just have a look on that. So I didn't include it in here. Anything else?
So just to add on to this, the question what you asked, we use something, we use dynamic inventory for deploying of containers in cloud. So we use Ansible scripts for that. So we provision the VMs and deploy containers.
Is the cloud provider separate? Who is the
cloud? No, we do it as part of VM
internal.
Yeah. So you can also specify Docker as the place where you want to provision things, which I didn't show. It's obviously not on the context of introduction. So you can do a whole lot of things. Just check on the docs. You have modules ranging from. So I'm just showing the docs here, right? I mean, you have modules ranging from managing your database servers, cryptography modules, network modules, our own Cisco servers, the Cisco routers and switches. There are modules for even that. I mean, and you have a whole lot of, I cannot even scroll down that long, right? So
it's easy to really manage all the Linux servers.
I'm sorry?
It really works for Windows also.
So there is a way of managing Windows, but it was not there some time back, right? It's something which has been since around maybe 1.8. I'm not sure about the version, Ansible version, which actually helps you manage. So there is support, but you need to get a lot of things which actually defeats the whole purpose. So you can actually manage your Windows servers and stuff using Ansible too. Not saying you cannot, but you need to get some things up and running before doing that.
You mentioned that the operations are idempotent.
Yeah.
But then some aren't.
Yeah, especially the module called shell.
Right.
Like, let's say I'm...
I think the module called apt is idempotent because it somehow manages to read the app configuration. So what are package managers and other tools are supported which are idempotent?
So mostly the design, it was designed as such that most of the modules which you would be finding in that page, right? The all modules page inside Ansible, they try as hard as possible to make that idempotent, right? So as I said, right, something which you are using on the shell, like configuring or copying some file, it's not supposed to be idempotent inherently. But you can do a hack where you can actually check whether that file, as I said, right, checking the regexes. Yeah. Let's say a particular line called taftic is inside that configuration file. If it exists, I am not executing that particular copy file. So
like, does it support say git, where you can say git, check out this?
Yeah. So one very common task would be to deploy. If I got your question right, you were just saying let's say I have a Git repo and I'm deploying it on my server and running something from that Git repo. Was that the question?
So checking out the revision is an idempotent. Mm-hmm. Should be an idempotent. So does it support that?
I think it should be idempotent, but you should check. So you're saying checking out a revision. Would that be idempotent or not? So there is a Git module also.
Support that?
I think it would be supported because there is a module called Git where you can directly specify the repository which you are cloning and the version and the head or whatever, right? So I think it should be idempotent, but I'm not sure on that part. You should probably check the docs.
My next question was, you have a list of tasks.
Yeah.
And say one of them fails.
Yeah. So it fails all along.
So but then
the task doesn't get executed after that.
No, but is there some support for, say, reverting those
changes?
The previous one, because say I wanted the whole thing to be transactional,
yeah.
Either atomic or transactional, right?
Yeah. So, I think you could put it...
Because you wouldn't want to end up with a half-deployed...
Yeah. I think you can probably put some event handlers on top of it.
Actually, you have a playbook which you are updating. You have always a playbook to revert back also. I think you should.
Okay, so
I mean, there is. It's not. I don't think it will really support, but you can start where it stopped. Again, you can move forward wherever it is. For example, you are doing 100 hosts. That is 50 is applied, and 51 it is failed. For 51 remaining, you can do it. That's possible. But once in one server it fails, I think you should have a. Probably at least my understanding, whatever it is, you have a playbook which will bring back to your previous position then.
So you have to write the revert playbook manually.
And you have that. I think probably previous version.
We don't need to write another playbook for that. We can handle it and then invoke some shell script or something as part of that handling and revert back everything.
Yes, you write code to revert.
Yeah, something like that.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
And also most of the times you never use root as a user or in username. Everything happens using such private key and public key.
Yeah. So this was just for the sake
demo.
Of the demo.
Yeah.
So there would be a lot of red
flags.
I'm
not talking about these, but
there would be a lot of
in
red
general,
flags.
We don't use username.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I'm reading a non-root user which has sudo permissions inside my, let's say, root server.
The only one problem we face with Ansible is the host key authentication.